I bet some of you here this morning could use prayer. I know I can. I often need prayer. But I want to invite you, if you're going through it, whether it be relationship, health, just needing God's provision, needing God's wisdom, you're kind of in a place where, man, if God, you've been crying out to God maybe for a while, and you're waiting on God to provide an answer, to show you a way, to touch you in some way. I'd like you to stand right where you're at, because I'd like to pray for you. Whatever it is that you think you might need prayer for. And I'll tell you, there is no shame in needing prayer. In fact, God delights in it. He delights in our humility. He delights in the fact that we say, help. Help me. He loves that. Now, if you are near one of these people standing, if you're comfortable with it, if they're comfortable with it, would you put a hand on their shoulder? And I'm going to pray for them, but I want you to pray along as well. And so go ahead and put a hand on their shoulder. And let's, as a family, a church family, let's pray for one another. Heavenly Father, you know the intricate details of whatever's going on in these people's lives. You know the pain, the confusion, the discomfort, whatever it may be, God, you know what they need, and they have been crying out to you. And so, God, we ask on their behalf that you would meet them right where they're at, that you would remind them of your presence, of your goodness, of your love. And that, God, if it be your will, that you would, in fact, answer their prayer. Answer their prayer according to the desires of their heart. And God, we will be careful to give you all the credit and all the glory, because you deserve it, God. And we give you thanks even in advance for the healing, for the comfort, for the provision, for the hearts that are being changed even in this moment. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Thank you for that. So we are in the second week of a series on faith. Last week we talked about Hannah and what it was like for Hannah to have faith as a barren woman desiring to be a mom. And today we're going to pick up in Genesis chapter 12, where we left off like 2 years ago. We spent a long time going through Genesis chapter 1 all the way through 11, and then we stopped almost 2 years ago. And we're going to pick it up, and it's going to take us pretty much through the rest of the summer as we work our way through these characters, these fathers, and these mothers of our faith. And I've entitled the series, Resilient Faith. And the subtitle I really like, A Faith That Stands the Test of Life. And I bet you're being tested, or will soon be tested, or have recently been tested by God. And that is one thing that we are promised. God never tempts us, but we are tested. And that testing comes out of a heart of goodness and out of a desire of God to see good things happen in your life. And one of my favorite movie scenes that talks about faith is from an old movie from 1989. Maybe you're familiar with it. It's one of the Indiana Jones movies. And this is a scene, you've probably seen it before, but I call it the leap of faith. Take a look at this.
Impossible. Nobody can jump this.
Indy!
And you must hurry!
Come quickly!
Thank you.
of faith. And I don't know if you caught the imagery there, but there's his father saying, you must leave. You must leave. And he takes this step of faith where he can't see the path that is there. And that is so much like the story that we're going to talk about today, which is the story of Abram, the father of our faith. So I'm going to pick it up in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. It says this, the Lord had said to Abram, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land that I will show you. And then he gives this huge promise. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all the people of the earth will be blessed through you. It's the heart of God. God has always had a heart to be a blessing to us and to the people of this world. And so Abram went, and as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old. It's not too late. I don't care how old you are. I don't care how old you are. God's not done with you. If you have a pulse, go ahead, check. Come on, check. You got a pulse, you got a purpose. I don't care how old you are. Abram is 75 years old. And so he set out from Haran. He took his wife, Sarai, his nephew Lot, and all the possessions that they had accumulated, and the people that they had acquired in Haran. Now, he grew up in Ur. He was called from Ur, but he had this little pit stop where his dad eventually died. But he spent a number of years in that little town. And they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. Abram traveled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring I will give this land. And so he built an altar there to the Lord who had appeared to him. In other words, he worshiped God. From there, he went on toward the hills east of Bethel and pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. And then Abram set out and continued toward the Negev. Two-thirds of the world population today look to Abraham as the father of their faith. Christians, Jews, and Muslims. Two-thirds of the world's population. And all three of these faiths believe in a single, all-powerful God. They all believe in Adam and Eve. They all agree that the world that we live in is messed up because of the rebellion and disobedience of Adam and Eve. And all three trace their starting point to this man, Abraham, who would be the beginning of God's plan to fix the world that we live in, and more personally, to fix and work on you and I. Now, three of my five kids broke their arm in kindergarten. My youngest two from the monkey bars, or not my youngest two, my middle and second one, that's Caleb and Kira there. My youngest Johnny broke his arm falling off a stool while brushing his teeth. And I think if a kid doesn't break his arm when he's a kid, he's not trying. He's not having fun. But I'll never forget when my wife got the call, and I got the call from Houston Elementary when my daughter, now 19 years old, had pretty badly broken her arm and wrist falling off the monkey bars. And I'll never forget what my wife said, because it was bad. And my wife looked at her and said to her, I told you to be more careful. I hope it hurts. Maybe you'll be more careful next time. This is going to be really expensive, and so you're going to have to pay this back someday. Now, you're laughing because you know I'm lying. You know I'm not telling the truth. That is not my wife, and that's not how she would respond. But here's the thing. Some of you actually think that's how God treats you. When you've messed up, when you've fallen, when you've broken something, you think God treats you like that. And if you think about it for a minute, that would make my wife, who did not treat her like that, more compassionate and more loving than God. here's the thing. The story of Abraham is a story about God, not just Abraham. Your story is not just about you, but about God. And Abraham's story is going to tell us a better story about God. A God who takes this messed up, broken world, sinful world that we live in, and a God who is full of love and full of compassion and says, come to me, follow me, trust me, obey me. I've got a plan to fix this world, and I've got a plan to fix you. And the process began one day when Abram got a call from God. And there's three aspects to this call that I want to discuss with you today. And the first one is that God called Abraham to himself. God says to Abram, I will make your name great. He called him out of Ur.
Right.
But what's significant is not just to where he was calling him, but who Abram was being called to. And God was calling him first to himself. See, that call of God is what makes you a Christian, those of you who claim to follow Christ. You're not a Christian if you don't respond to the call. It always starts with that invitation. It always starts with that call. Come to me, trust me, follow me. You know, it's what guides and directs our lives. It's what moves you from a life of selfishness and self-centeredness to a life of selflessness and service. What moves you from a life of brokenness to a life of wholeness. Human history at this point had pretty much come to a dead end. The human race had spiraled so down into violent, depraved, idol-worshipping world that God was not ready to get rid of it completely like with Noah in his day. But he poked in this dark world and he chose a man. And that man would become a family. And that family would become a nation. And through that nation, God would reveal himself and eventually bring the Messiah into the world. Now, in Joshua chapter 24, Joshua's looking back on the history of them as a people. And he says this about their ancestors. Long ago, your ancestors, including Terah, the father of Abraham, lived beyond the Euphrates River and worshipped other gods. Terah was an idol worshiper. Abraham was brought up to be an idol worshiper. In fact, a lot of scholars think Terah was actually involved with buying and selling and making idols. And so this last little nut light of the knowledge of God that had come down from Noah to Shem all the way to Abram was about to flicker out. Spiritually, the human race had come to a dead end. And somewhat physically too, because Sarai is barren. Not only is she physically barren, unable to have children, it is a metaphor of the condition of the human race. Barren, spiritually barren, dead. And so this last family that is carrying the knowledge of God is about to end. And that's when God breaks through. Now, Abraham grew up in Ur of Chaldees, and there has been a lot of archaeological discoveries about this city. The Euphrates River eventually moved. It used to be right up against the Euphrates River, and so when the Euphrates River moved, people moved. Back in the early 1900s, this was discovered. Here's a picture of a ziggurat, which is about a third of the size it would have been. And they have found so many things as they have dug in this area because it's been nothing but desert and barren for a couple of millennia. But what they think is that this city, Ur, was inhabited by about 300,000 people in a 4-square-mile area. That's a little tight. It's a little busy for me. But they've also learned that there was a huge library here where students learned the basics like writing, reading, arithmetic, as well as accounting, banking, mathematics, astronomy, botany, geology, and even medicine. They found some stuff that they think was used like aspirin today. But they also lived in spiritual darkness. They practiced grotesque polytheistic worship that included child sacrifice and temple prostitutes. And Ur, at this time, they think was the center of lunar worship, that is, worship of the moon. And interestingly, Abram, who would have been about 58 years old, when, if you go by the timeline in Genesis and how long people lived, which some people take literally, some people don't, but if it is literal, then Noah would have died when Abram was 58 years old. So think about that. When Noah came off the boat out of the flood, how many people lived on the earth? Unless you believe in a local flood. I personally think it was a worldwide flood, but there would have been 8 people. So I did a little mathematics. I put some stuff into ChatGPT. Hopefully it's right. But given circumstances being perfect, and if you know, Noah had 3 kids, say each of his sons had 3 kids, and so on and so on and so on, the world population would have gone from 8 people to the time of Abraham to over 1 billion people, given perfect circumstances. Of course, that wasn't the case. There was wars, there was disease, there was death, there was barrenness, all kinds of stuff. But I think it's safe to say the world population over 290 years was pretty big at this point. And here's what I also find interesting. They have uncovered royal graves that date back 500 years before Abraham, where they have discovered that Ur was made up of skilled engineers, architects. They had knowledge of farming. They had artisans as well as celebrated jewelers. So Abram and his family would have been a part of a very prominent family on earth. They had wealth, they had comfort, they were sophisticated, educated. It was the most advanced known city of the time. And it's likely the oldest and first people that developed writing. But without the call of God, it all amounted to nothing. It doesn't matter what kind of family you grow up in, it doesn't matter about your past. It doesn't matter if you've messed up or you've had great success in life. And it's nice. It means nothing without the call of God on your life. You know, I've raised 5 kids, still raising 5 kids to some degree. And it's not easy to be raised in a pastor's home. Most of my kids struggled with it at one level or another, but they really just wanted to be left alone and treated like normal kids. But just because they grew up in a pastor's home, just because they grew up in a nice home, just because they were brought up in church and had good lives, still have good lives, unless the call of God comes on them, that disturbs them, that convicts them, that disrupts them, unless they respond to the call of God like Abraham does here, they'll grow up to be nice people. They might even go to church. They might even pray. They might even believe in God. But they will simply be nice little idol worshipers like Abram. But the thing that made Abram great and why 3 religions look back on him as the beginning, as the starting point of faith, it's that what gives us significance. That's the thing that will guide and direct our lives. It's how we respond to the call of God. Have you responded to the call of God? And the call of God is first an invitation to come to Jesus, to come to Him, to come to God. As you are, not as you ought to be. You don't fix your life and then come to God. You come as you are, and then He begins to work on you and to fix your life. And here's the thing about the call of God that we wrestle with. It's not an easy call. It's not a call that is predictable. It's not a call that is a call to comfort and ease. It's not a call to a smooth path. But it's a good call. See, Abram is called to leave his family, to leave the city, to leave all the comforts and all the stuff that he has, and God says, I'll tell you where to go. Just go. I'm not going to tell you all the details right now. You just go. And then he's told that he's going to be the father of a great nation. Well, God, hello, God, I don't have any kids. That's okay. Just go. Trust me. I'll tell you later. We see this often. We see this often in our own lives, in our own stories. God calls us to something, and then we wait. And we wonder. But what's significant here is that because Abram responded to this call, not only to leave, but to come to God, to come to the one true God, he changed world history. He absolutely changed world history, and God lit a light that burns to this day. And so the call begins with a call to God, a call to a relationship with God, a call to fellowship with God, a call to follow and trust and obey God. But secondly, it is a call to a new identity. This is fast forwarding the story a little bit, but when Abram is 99, God changes his name to Abraham. And this idea of a name and a name being changed is significant in biblical history, and it's huge. But it has to do, the changing of the name has to do with a person's purpose and identity. In fact, back in 2015, not too long ago, the word identity was the word of the year in dictionary.com. Now, I'm not sure if these stories are real, but I did a little research, and you can find people now that identify as an animal, a cat, or something else. We live in a weird world. Some people, even stranger to me, identify as the weather. One person identified as rain. Other people identify as plants or concept. Imagine identifying as a concept or even a cloud. One person, teenager, identifies as a cloud, and this is what he said. I look at a cloud, and I see it as me. I'm a cloud. We live in a strange world. But identity has to do with how you view yourself. Identification is what you show to Costco when you go in and say, I'm a member, I can buy here. But identity has to do with how you view you. It's how you think of yourself. And we all have identities that have been shaped and formed by different things. The family you grew up in, the experiences you had, the culture that we live in, things that were told to you, skills that you have, talents that you have. All of these things can name us, can be our identity. But identity has to do with where you find worth, where you find value, where you find significance. And when God calls us to himself, he not only sends us out, but he gives us a new name. He gives us a new identity. And this issue of identity is incredibly important. You can never embrace and walk in the life that God is inviting you to if you don't know who you are. You can't be who you are meant to be until you know who you are. Now check this out. This is kind of cool. Abram means father. Here's a guy with no children, and his name is Daddy. Then God changes his name to Abraham, which means father of many, or as I like to say, big daddy. And what's incredible is that God changed his name before he had kids. He had no kids. Imagine life for Abraham. Hey, Abraham, that's big daddy to you. Imagine what that was like. What's your identity based on? What names you? And I've learned over the years that I don't care how, you know, a person presents themselves, for most people, especially many Christians that I've talked to, there is an identity that was imprinted on them in childhood, and as adults they have a hard time shedding that because they have believed it for so long. What names you? Is it failure, loser, rejected, alone, divorced, dropout? Is it your past? Is it your talent? Is it your family? Is it your finances? Is it your job? Is it the mistakes you made? Is it your stunning good looks? Is it your kids or your talents? There's all kinds of things that can name us. There's all kinds of things that we build our identity on. God wants to shed those things. Because when we come to him, he says, some of that might be good, some of that might be bad, but I'm going to give you a new name, a new identity. Some of you maybe been to a seminar or something where you got a name tag that looked like this. My name is. And of course, you write in your name, right? But what many of you don't know, and maybe you know this, but you don't believe it yet, here's what God says about your identity. Here's what God names you, and this is just a few. Your name is Beloved Child. 1 John 1:9, your name is Forgiven. 2 Corinthians 5, your name is New Creation. John 15, you are a friend of God. John 15 also, you're chosen by God. Or like this one in Isaiah chapter 43, verse 4, your name is precious to God. There's actually an NBA player whose name is Precious. His parents named him Precious, and here he is, this 6'7" beast in the NBA. Make fun of his name. Or how about Ephesians chapter 2? Your name is Masterpiece. You are God's workmanship. Or Romans 8:28, your name is Called by God. See, this is what calls you. This is what your name is. This is your new identity. It's the moment you step into that relationship with Jesus, you are given a new name, a new identity. Are you living by the old identity? Are you living by the new identity? And so God calls us to himself, and then God calls us to a new identity and to live out of that new identity. And then thirdly, he calls us to be a blessing. Notice the promise that God gives Abram. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. In fact, I am going to bless the whole world through you. And see, that's the way God works with us even today. He brings us to himself and says, I bless you, and then he sends us out to be a blessing. He brings us in, not to keep us in, but to send us out with that blessing to be a blessing to others. And it's no different for you and me than it was for Abram. And I've come to believe one of the reasons so many Christians struggle and feel stuck and they don't know what to do and they don't know why they are and who they are and they want to make an impact, they want to serve, they want to be a blessing, but they struggle with it. And part of it is, you know, we're just selfish people sometimes. It's a, what's in it for me? What do I get out of it? But I think the biggest reason is that most people don't feel qualified. I'm not good enough. And to this day, you know, I've been in ministry over 30 years, and I still feel unqualified. But here's what I want you to see about Abraham's life. The call of God did not come to Abraham because he was qualified. He was qualified because he was called. He was qualified because he was called, and he responded to the call. Abraham was not a great person in his own right. He was a mess. He grew up as an idolater. Twice he doubted God's provision and he fled to another land, where twice he convinced his wife to tell the Pharaoh that she was just his sister. Out of fear for himself, he threw his wife under the bus. And then he and Sarah decided to take matters into their own hands, and Sarah gave her husband, her servant. And like an idiot, Abraham said, oh, okay, sure. See, God did not call Abraham because he was qualified. He qualified him because he was called. There's a true story. Some of the facts might have been embellished a little bit, but what we have gathered back in the medieval times around the mid-1100s, there was a very famous king from England named King Henry II. And he was a very godless man. There was always conflict between him, the state, and the church. He wanted authority. He wanted power over the church. And he had a kind of a low-level priest that was one of his best friends. They were hunting buddies and drinking buddies. And his name was Thomas Becket. And when the Archbishop of Canterbury died, King Henry II thought, I have my chance. I will appoint my buddy, my drinking buddy, to be the archbishop, and that way I can have influence and I can have power and authority over the church. But when Thomas Becket, and he didn't want this call, he rejected, he said, this is going to change everything in our relationship. But King Henry II wouldn't listen. He had nothing with it. And so he made him and appointed him as the Archbishop of Canterbury. And it completely changed Thomas Becket. He began to be filled with this huge sense of responsibility and accountability to God. And it really frustrated King Henry. And so one night, kind of in a fit, he was drunk. He kind of spurted out, "Who will rid me of this burden?" And four of his knights took that as an opportunity or as a request or as an invitation to go down to the church and kill Thomas Becket. And in fact, that's exactly what they did. We're told, tradition says anyway, that as they entered into the church with their swords, Thomas uttered out loud, "Father, forgive him. He knows not what he does." See, the call of God radically changed him. When he realized the significance of being called by God, he suddenly became qualified. And that's grace. That's grace at work. Long before the Greek word grace existed. And that's why it's so important for you and I to find and to discover where we belong, our purpose, why God has called us to himself, to find our calling. And we live in a world where we still are trying to shed, as Protestants, this clergy-laity distinction. There is no clergy-laity distinction in the New Testament. We are all followers of Jesus. We are all called by God, to God, and to be a blessing to others. It looks different for me than it does for you. How does it look for you? How is it that God has called you to be a blessing to others? It doesn't matter if you fully know what it is right now. I started out when I gave my life to Christ and decided to volunteer. The very first thing I began to do was to wash communion cups. Now, there was a cute girl involved, so, you know, what can I say? But for about a year, I did that. I washed communion cups and was very happy to do it. I had no idea what God could do with my life. I was just a dumb jock. And eventually a door opened up and I began to travel all around the world with a stupid basketball that would open doors for evangelism and discipleship. And I got to tell people about Christ. On one of those trips, I ended up doing some part-time youth ministry, which led me to serve in youth ministry here in the States, which led to me doing what I do now. We never know where that calling is going to take us. We're simply asked to go and to trust and to obey. And you are called to be a blessing to others. One of the things that fills my heart with joy, more than anything else I can think of as a pastor at this church, is when I hear stories about so-and-so visiting, so-and-so, and calling so-and-so, and spending time with so-and-so, and having lunch with so-and-so, and these ladies to get together for prayer and pray for me and for the church. And when that kind of stuff is happening that I'm not producing, that I'm not making happen, it's just simply grassroots God, people serving and loving and being blessing to one another and to the community that we live in, just blesses my heart so much. You are called to be a blessing. And you're qualified more than you know. You're qualified because you're called. Now, Christianity is not a call to predictability. It's not a call to comfort. It's a call to an unknown adventure. It's disruptive. It's unpredictable. But it's always, always, always good. It's harder than you can imagine it will be, but it's always better than you could imagine it would be. And we have this simple promise. We have this simple promise from God. Not that he'll smooth every path, not that he'll make things easy, not that it won't be more complicated or confusing or more difficult than we think it should be. The promise we have is that he will be with us. Abram lived with that knowledge. He believed God. He trusted God. And so first and foremost, that call is a call to relationship, a call to friendship with God. It starts with that. Have you accepted the call? Maybe you've accepted the call, but you've sat ever since wondering, okay, what am I supposed to do? What am I supposed to do? Figure it out. Pray. Go. Do. Be a blessing. Wake up every morning and say, in fact, put this on a note next to your bed. How can I be a blessing to someone? Imagine the impact on this world if we all lived with that calling. Abraham is a great man of faith, but his greatness did not come from his ability to conjure up faith. We'll talk more about faith in the weeks to come. But the key was that he trusted God. It's about the object of our faith, not the amount of faith we have. You may have faith so small, it is like a mustard seed, the smallest known seed at the time. And that's all you need. Because it's not the amount of faith you have, it's who your faith is in. And he calls you to himself. He calls you to a new identity. And he calls you to be a blessing. And there was another like Abraham who would come many, many years later. And he would leave his home. He would leave the glory of heaven. He would leave where for all eternity he had perfect love, perfect fellowship as a part of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And however long angels existed, they worshiped him day and night, 24/7, holy, holy, holy. And he left that. He left that for you so that you could be with him. And he suffered greatly. And he died an agonizing death on the cross. But he rose again from dead. And he invites us to the same thing that Abram was invited to. Go. Be with me. Follow me. I will make you something great. And you will be a blessing to many. Father, thank you for your word, and thank you for the story of Abram, who becomes Abraham. And God, his story, our story is part of his story. We are here today because of his faithfulness, because of his obedience, because of his trust in you. We too call him the father of our faith. But God, right now we want to celebrate the fact that you left heaven. You obeyed the Father. You left the comfort and the glory of heaven to walk this messed up world, in this messed up world. And you were beaten and crucified and died for us. And so God, if you're willing to do that for us, God, may we have the courage, may we have the faith to take that leap that looks scary, that looks daunting, that looks impossible. May we take that step of faith and follow you, whatever that means, whatever that looks like.